Welcome to Delphi IBS. It's a privilege to have you all in today's launch of a regional inclusive growth project organized by the Consumer Unity and Trust Society, or CUTS International. Welcome. With collaborating research institutes in India, the Philippines, and Vietnam. The project has an earlier launch of this in Vietnam. In the Philippines, the PIDS is the collaborating research institute. The primary objective of the project is to highlight the need to strengthen the digital economy in each of the program countries, namely India, Vietnam, and the Philippines. The project seeks to address the following questions. What are the general potential benefits and accompanying risks or costs that the internet and digital technologies could bring for consumers and citizens? This part of the research will capture prominent sectors, namely health, education, finance, and governance. Second, will the existing framework, referring to regulations, policies, initiatives, infrastructure, act as an enabler for digital transformation? Third, what are the stakeholders' experiences and perceptions of the benefits and accompanying risks brought about by the digital tools and platforms? Fourth, what are the bottlenecks and barriers which have been impeding people's use of the digital tools and platforms? Are there any obstructions in the existing framework that deter businesses from going digital and opt for continuing with conventional practices? The final question in the research project is that what are the necessary measures, interventions, and actions required to promote digital participation and digital transformation throughout the country for more inclusive growth? Today's symposium, The Digital Economy, Potential Benefits, Challenges, and Implications of Regulation, signals the start of the research process in the Philippines, for this project I mean. It is very timely, considering that the digital economy, a radical transformation of the economy, is rapidly upon us, consumers and producers alike. In 2013, the World Economic Forum forecasts that by 2016, the digital economy is likely to reach $4.2 trillion in the G20 economies, more than 5% of GDP. I haven't checked the actual figures for 2016, but we can bet that the digital economy has reached a significant proportion of GDP in those developed economies, and soon the developing economies will not be an exception as economies become more integrated and more closely linked. E-commerce, for instance, has shown rapid growth in both developed and developing countries. The DTI's e-commerce roadmap report indicates that in 2015, the projected sales through e-commerce in China stands at $562, rivaling that of the U.S. at $349 billion, and $94 billion in the United Kingdom. As you can see, the digital economy is transforming the way we produce and consume, in as much as we as consumers and producers create the digital economy. Digitization, the Internet of Everything, big data, advanced analytics, all these disruptive technologies all interact in a variety of ways, creating new waves of innovation, productivity, and growth in a manner that has not been seen before. It is changing the landscapes of jobs, producers, product, and service markets. Big names such as Apple, Google, Amazon, Alibaba, Facebook, and others are trailblazers in addressing consumer needs, with many firms, big and small, joining the bandwagon, so to speak. There are significant benefits of the digital economy, consumers, and society at large. An important point to consider, which we will discuss today, is the huge potential for inclusiveness of growth in a digital economy. An immediate example is the way financial technology firms are presently competing with traditional brick-and-mortar private lending institutions in providing financial products and services to those who have been traditionally financially excluded. And these are those people, especially in the countryside. Governments have used the digital infrastructure in improving the delivery of public services such as health services, education, among others, which make public services more inclusive. There are significant growth opportunities as well for businesses, as indicated very well by the shift to online trade and services that enable a quick response to varying consumer preferences in terms of product or service availability, quality, and lower prices. For instance, the retail sector has successfully used digital technologies to create effective database management systems, client-server platforms, enterprise planning software, computerized management tools for inventory, and product and services delivery. These all contribute to improve efficiency and their ability to cope with the growing demands of consumers. E-commerce illustrates these advances. Amazon, for example, a well-known web-based retailer, caters a worldwide market at a fraction of the cost of inventory and shipping. In the Philippines, online shops such as Lazada and ride-hailing services have responded quite well to consumer demand by using disruptive technologies to connect more efficiently buyers and sellers in the goods and services markets. However, even as the digital economy looks like a new fountainhead of growth and development, it poses deep challenges, among which is how to structure and apply regulation in a digital world. What is the regulatory environment of the future? At this point, allow me to borrow some thoughts from Bruce Weingart of the World Economic Forum. He says, in fast-moving industries, regulators struggle to keep up with market and technological developments. As we know, economic agents are very well ahead of regulators. Regulators come in later, as you can see in this big discussion between Uber and LTFRB. What should be the balance among innovation, affordability, and access? Historically, relevant regulation has been spread across several agencies. Now, this siloed approach may be outdated as lines blur across industries and as digital services increasingly ignore national borders. Regulatory approaches that only address challenges on an individual sector or national basis will likely be suboptimal. The implication is that regulators would need to develop more effective coordination mechanisms to deal with this new phenomenon that does not respect national boundaries or individual sectors. Along with the benefits of digitization are the challenges posed by cybersecurity, you all know this, data and privacy breaches, cyberbullying, assignment of liability, and a host of other challenges, including fake news. In time, regulators can develop a sense of what and how to regulate, but they have to consider as well the need to encourage innovations and experimentations that may create new pathways for inclusive services. It is also critical to educate consumers and build their capacity to navigate the digital world to increase their level of welfare. Today's symposium is a good and appropriate step in the right direction, the first step of so many steps to take by focusing on the role of three key actors in the digital world: government, producers, and consumers. Please allow me to congratulate CUTS International and PIDS for organizing this project and symposium, and all of you participants for taking time and braving the traffic of EDSA and Quezon Avenue to come here and partake of the delightful morsels of new ideas, new approaches, and for the uninitiated like me, a new understanding of the benefits and challenges offered by the digital economy. Once again, thank you for coming. Let's look forward to fruitful activity.